Hello to everyone. Today I'm going to be reading another Creepypasta ASMR story called The Masked Man. If you guys enjoy the video, don't forget to like and subscribe and comment down below. Have a wonderful night. Tuesday, October 11th. Today I drove my 7-year-old son James into the town to go Halloween shopping. I didn't have to buy any candy this year because we lived in a cul-de-sac out in the middle of a farming community on the outskirts of the city. I moved last year because I had divorced my wife and lost my old house along with the custody of James. It's rather the shitty end of the stick, but James and I love Halloween. It's one of the few times here that Tracy finds it acceptable for my only son to come visit me. James stays with her on every other holiday throughout the year, his birthday and everything else in between. I get to see him only on my B-day and the week preceding Halloween, unless the high bitch court finds it's suitable for him to come spend the night every once in a while. Frankly, I'm surprised she let him come shopping with me. Upon pursuing the aisles, James showed a strong affinity to a flamboyant green and purple Buzz Lightyear costume. It's really typical for a kid to have an eye for the most expensive thing on the rack, but I didn't have the heart to say no to those bottomless blue eyes. He also picked out all the house decoration. I know we won't be getting any trick-or-treaters out where I live, but adorning the exterior of our home was always one of our favorite things to do together. Friday, October 21st. It looks like James and I will be having some competition for the best Halloween decoration. Our heart, sadly enough, in this neighborhood is only a pat on the back. When I live with James and my ex-wife, he and I won the trophy every year since he was 3. Reminiscence aside, my next door neighbor is really giving us a run for our money. He did quite a splurge on decoration. He must have ordered everything online, because aside from the cliche Happy Halloween banners and the like, the festive treasure found in his house and lawn were nowhere to be seen in the store where James and I shopped, which sold only festive decor. The fellow garage door sat below a strand of guide string, on which hung dozens of expensive looking bones and skulls. He also placed several other bones sticking straight up out of his lawn. There was no color or detail, just random bones placed here and there, strewn about his unkept lawn. Truly though, he's nothing. Saturday, October 22nd. While walking through my house at dusk outside the dining room window, I notice a quick flicker of movement dash in and out of my peripherals as I was preparing for James' week-long stay. I inspect it. I don't even know if I should be glad that I did. I walked back in front of the window and saw the same animation, but this time in the center of my vision. I walked back away from the window and slowly I peeked out from the corner of the glass. I made out the shape of the very top of a person's head peering over the top of my fence, and it seemed to be watching me. Whoever it was stuck down again right after they realized we had made eye contact. I backed away from the window. I don't know why. I crawled over to the family room window, which was about 15 to 20 feet to the left, but facing the same direction as the dining room window. I stayed knelt, timidly but curiously grasping the curtain. I ever so slowly pulled back the glove, only to gaze upon the masked fellow who was snooping around behind my property. This time I saw his entire head, the mask had a gaping, dangling mouth, similar to the mask used in the Scream movie series. The only difference was the jaw of this particular mask was swaying about in the wind, and also had teeth, long, thin, fang-like growths that appeared almost like the stranding hanging from the mouth of a whale, though fewer in numbers. The expressions on the mask was plain, and the color was rather pale, with slight gray discoloration. It didn't have a goofy smile or an intimidating stare, just a mouth hanging wide open on a couple of perfect round, beady little chameleon eyes, eerily shaded. After about 10 seconds of the observation, one of the eyes appeared as it was steadily drifting off. Away from it was a fixated and very slow, began to scan to the left, and as soon as he seemed to look on to where I was, he quickly disappeared. Tuesday, October 25th. I don't really know my neighbor, much less where he gets all of his decoration. I know there's a new ornament of sorts in front of his door today. It was a ceramic bowl full of guts, comically placed where he would place a bowl of candy, were he too lazy to answer the door for trick-or-treaters. Behind it was a large white piece of paper bound to the wall of the house. On it was written a nearly illegible chicken scratch. Take one. The whole sign had bloody fingerprints smeared all over it. More convinced yet was the bloody tape on the bloody wall. Nearly the entire wall was smeared in a brown, white, spooky. The stream of blood that ran from the handprints were strangely enough dry. I didn't know they made enough of the blood that could dry like that. Wednesday, October 26th. Ever since James arrived early this week, he has simply abhorred the idea of removing his costume. Little Bus has been running rampant through the house, quoting the Toy Story. He hasn't disrobed once since he put it on. Save for him, I demand he allowed me to wash it, because he was quite literally rolling around outside in the dirt. I haven't seen any more of this weirdo in the mask lately. Probably some mischievous skit from the neighborhood behind mine. It's a cul-de-sac too, just a bigger one. There's a dirt road that accompanies an irrigation canal separate the two neighborhoods. My house is the farthest house from the main road, and the canals run parallel to my fence. I didn't know of any bridge he could have used to come across, but I never looked back there, and I don't particularly care to. Neighbor man bought an ornament 200 feet of lights to accompany the 200 feet of intestine he had previously thrown all over the tree in his front yard. The light coexists uniquely with the prior decor, though all I could smell when I went outside was the burning odor of sizzling assembled of mixed-matched decorations hanging from the tree. The moisture of these oddly generous-looking innards had adhered to his archive festive bulbs, producing a deep red glow. Intentionally or not, the smell was almost enough to coerce a complaint out of me. Almost, come to think of it, the smell wasn't so bad, almost like a barbecue. Friday, October 28th. I'm going insane. No simple words can probably describe what I have witnessed. As the sun was setting this evening, I got another glimpse of the masked man. What I saw was what I would describe as a mask. I was sitting in my living room, reading the bay window, and my living room overlooked the entire street, and I had my blinds open. I had started and looked up out of the window towards the nearly dissipated sun, because I had heard what sounds like an asthmatic man gasping for air through a megaphone over the top of a vocal frightened cat. I stood up from the couch and walked briskly towards the window. I kept my hands above my eyes to deter the sunlight and pressed my face against the window. And I saw it. I was pursuing a small cat. It ran like an oil streak. Where it was not bald and discolored, it was spotted with long patches of blind hairs and networks of pulsating blue veins, veining isolated strands of gray hair flat against its flaky, decomposed head. Its flapping, low-hung chin keeping rhythm with its bounding stride as a sprinting thing began to overtake a creature built for agility. Ultra thin, ultra broad shoulders, dutiful, bounded up and down in harmony with its three branch-like arms, easily giving it at least a five-goat roach, mammoth hands, chopstick fingers, and those repulsive chameleon eyes. Buckets of drool spilled impatiently from behind it, green behind its hellish teeth. A misshaped, stilt like legs complete the horrific image altogether. I observed an 8.5-foot freak show with a crazy hair, particularly leaping from the yard to yard, chasing this poor kitten for a reason ostensibly beyond simple sustenance. The cat approached the fence on the left of the street. I leapt towards a delusion of safety. The beast proceeded to effortlessly jump from the sidewalks over the lawn and snatches the animal from the top of the fence with his talon-like claws, as a falcon might. The cat didn't stand a chance, nor did it even manage to voice a squeal. The thing disappeared into the shadows with its arm meal, an unforgettable 2.5 seconds. Then I thought of my son. He could have very well been in the place of the plaintive animal. No, I should never say such things. Regardless, what am I to do? Forgo what little time I have throughout the year with my boy, because a scary monster is on the loose? Tell my ex-wife that my neighborhood in the middle of nowhere has become too dangerous for our son to stay with me? By revel and hunt a thing myself, no matter. With only 2 days until Halloween, I doubt there will be any trouble. Saturday, October 29th. I've thought about calling the police, but for what exactly? I definitely couldn't call in and report a burglar or even anything human for that matter, because they wouldn't be looking for what needed to be caught. No one can know. Earlier tonight, my neighbor threw a street-wide costume party at their place down at the entrance of the street. I didn't go because I had to work late, and after I picked up James from his friend's house, we anticipated having a game night with just the two of us. Sometimes during the night, James took a bathroom break. He was gone for 50 minutes when he returned. He seemed excited to inform that he looked out the living room window in between the blinds, and what he described as a really tall, weird-looking person with a bag running patiently to the house where the party was being held. Empty bag In the end, according to James, it would disappear into the backyard of the house. And seconds later, pulled out of the yard with a full bag and tear off towards my neighbor's house, wearing a costume. It repeated this process several times, each time wearing a different costume than before. He said that in the last round, it stopped in the middle of the street, cocked its head to the right slightly, and its right eye slid to the side of its head and stared right at him, as if there weren't blinds between them. He said that even turned its head 180 degrees and locked eyes contact with him. And then a colossal mouth sluggishly transformed into a probing expression to the widest smile he thought he'd ever seen. Millions of teeth were his exact words. He said that its smile had then has tile collapsed, hastily collapsed, dropping the chin into a visible free fall, which ended with a swinging slap on its chest. It then darted off into my reclusive neighbor's yard, and that was when James decided to come alert me of his findings. I thought of what horrid monster smiling at my beautiful boy. I despised the idea. I tried to envision what that particular smile might look like, although I really couldn't. I don't think a flapping maw that gargantuan had the muscle to maneuver that flailing chin in the first place. Then again, it has to eat something. Sunday, October 30th. More decorations were stealthily as always, erected by my mysterious neighbor. A couple dozen or so skeletons, all different size, all dressed in cliche Halloween attire. There was a Marilyn Monroe skeleton, a Darth Vader skeleton, an Abraham Lincoln skeleton, so on, so forth. Every one of them was strung up by the back of its neck, feet swinging, head looking down. I really wanted to ask this guy how he comes up with all this. Ray gets it all. Perhaps if he knows that last night rain washed the color off of most of his little knickknacks. Gotta hand it to him, though. The slew of morbid decor, in combination with his filthy rundown cobweb covered home, emits a true horror movie feel. It's now just past midnight. I just finished with my work, I brushed my teeth, and now the doorbell rang again and again and again. Reluctantly, I rise up and walk towards the front of my door. I opened it. My neighbor, no, the freak next door, but the fellow who lives behind me on the other side of the canal, he's disgruntled. He's particularly out of breath and is threatening me about something, but none of it's sinking in because one of the skeletons hanging from my neighbor's tree, a newcomer, is staring right at me. Its jaw unhinged, unlike the others. It's smaller than the other skeleton and appears to be dripping with something. Moonlight reveals to me its eyes. Big, blue eyes. I turn to face the man yelling at me. Him. You're listening over there. Me? Oh yeah. Him. The hell you're trying to pull. He almost gave my wife a heart attack with the mask. Apparently my son and I aren't the only ones who have spotted the neighborhood missing link. How he could possibly confuse that thing with me. Him. And don't try and smooth talk your way out of this one, pal. I saw you jumping clean over that fence of yours. The hell you managed to do. That is still wandering and crawling right back into your basement. It's dark and all, but no type it was you, pal. Me, I'm terribly sorry I improvised. I don't know what came over me, if there's anything I can do. My heart sank. Wait here? There's no way. I'm running like a fool into my own house because this asshole bangs on my door at 12:15 in the morning to tell me that he saw this. thing jump into my basement, with my trembling hands applying convulsively energy to the doorknob. I turn and fling the door wide open to reveal my son, sleeping facing the wall, just as I left him. Figures, he's never all the way under the covers like that, but it's a bit cold in there, goddamn though. This guy at my door really does have some nerves. He scared the shit out of me. Sorry, I just interrupted him. Ah, save it. I ain't got no shits at all about your problems. Just stay the hell away from me and my family, yeah? Yeah, sure. A calming chuckle digs its way into his angry tone as I recognize those freshly familiar bottomless blue eyes stuffed inside the head of the skeleton. I gotta hand it to you, you know. I nearly bust out laughing when I saw you running around wearing the little kid's best lightyear costume. That was the end. I hope that you guys enjoyed the story. Have a wonderful night. Sweet dreams. Don't forget to like and subscribe.